data statistics to back this up, but this is how it has moved, we feel so. And now when we come to accessible gaming, the very first question people ask is, can accessible gaming be a business? First of all, people are not really ready to embrace the idea of accessible gaming. That is what we observe. And second thing is, obviously, whenever we say that accessibility in question, everybody asks about what is the business case. So Jayant will discuss the business case for you.
Yes, so here we have, the slide is very self-explanatory, about 12 million broadband subscribers. And when I say 12 million broadband subscribers, the users are many more. We have more than 840 million mobile phone users. And so all these guys are the part of the digital age. So of course, they will be playing games, small, big, paid, unpaid, free, whatever. But they do play games. So you have a huge chunk of population which is into digital gaming. So that ensures that we have about, by 2016, the gaming industry, the digital gaming industry, would be about $53 billion. As of moment, the Indian gaming market is approximately $1,060 billion. So it's just a huge industry. So there's a lot of money in it.
And so when we, now as Jayant discussed, it's already a business case. So business is one aspect that we need to take into consideration when we make games accessible. But when I was discussing this accessible gaming with few of my colleagues and maybe with people from disability area, I was like, roads which are not accessible. We have so many infrastructural facilities which are not accessible to disabled people. So is making games accessible a priority? And who is going to put up money in that? So that was one of the questions asked. And so I thought, like, we should answer this question through this presentation. And the answer is, gaming is all pervading. So gaming has not remained just a gaming for fun time or pastime, but it is spanning across education. We have serious games like management training. We have games to train people on different skills. Like, there are ability enhancer kind of games, like cognitive abilities, somebody said some time back. So if we play those games, we are going to help people to maintain their abilities, enhance their abilities. And so gaming is important for everyone. And here there is a pyramid. It's right?
Yeah, that's right. Same bottom picture. We have physical infrastructure.
So this is basically the basic inspiration for this pyramid is Maslow's hierarchy theory, which talks about the hierarchy of needs. So the first pyramid on the left, if I'm right, So it starts with physical infrastructure at the bottom. That is a basic need. Second is maybe education, then workplace accommodation, and finally at the top it is gaming. That is entertainment. But as we transition from that earlier perspective, with a lot of like digital gaming and all medical gaming, serious gaming coming into picture, the games come at the bottom. That becomes a basic necessity. And in India, as we see that there are so many people who do not have access to education because of their disability. If we can create game-like infrastructures which can be accessible at their home and they can take education through gaming kind of engines, I think we'll be able to serve masses. Therefore, we have another parameter, that pyramid, which talks about parameters in context of India.
So as you see in this pyramid here, we have games at all levels. So we have physical infrastructure, we really don't know what games to put there, but then when it comes to education infrastructure, yes, we can create education games. At workplace, we can have team building and all those kind of games which will help the person to become a good employee and improve skill set in this given domain. And of course, the games for entertainment. So games can games will pervade in every level out there. It's not that it's just for time pass. It's not that, right?
Okay. So now, as we established that game is a priority, we should look for how we can make games accessible. And before that, these are just characteristics of games. So if you can just read one by one.
So we have games as fun. Games lead to satisfaction. Games is challenges. Games for education. This is just kind of a summary that the points that were raised right in the beginning.
Right. And there is one more addition to this, which is specific to a person who is disabled. Like people, when they play games, they get a kind of satisfaction of doing those things which otherwise they cannot do. Like if I am playing in Second Life and I can maybe fly a plane there. So I know that in reality I cannot do that, but through those virtual reality games I can get that satisfaction which I cannot get otherwise. And therefore, we decided to first understand like what is the difference between a productivity software and a game software. Because as I said, whatever guidelines apply to productivity software, like for maybe a website, or say I have a banking package, what software accessibility guidelines apply to that, they may not apply as is to the game. That is what is our hypothesis. And here we are just listing the differences between them. First of all, can you just read one by one before we
Sure. So we have a productivity software out here, which is focused on completing a task. So I want to create a document. I want to finish the report by tomorrow. So that's my task. So I use MS Word, Microsoft Word for it. So there's a deadline to meet. I use a specific application software, which is a productivity software. And my focus is on completing the task. Game software, I play games because it is entertaining.
Right.
You have rewards are external. So when I create a document, I give it to my boss and he pats my back, I get a raise. That's so my reward is external. But when I'm playing games, it's basically it's an intrinsic reward. I enjoy. Oh, I got points. I won the game. Maybe I'm just sitting in the corner of my room and playing games. But then the fun is it comes within me. So you have, so these are the various points. So, this table highlights the difference between how a productivity software is different from a gaming software.
Right. So after we understood that there are certain differences like this, what we did first is we looked for guidelines to make games accessible. And when we searched for those guidelines, somehow the research which we did, or prior art research we did, was negative. The results were negative because we could not find any set of guidelines which are comparable to W3C, WCAG2 compliance level for gaming, specifically for gaming. But still, there are certain task force who are working in this area. I have listed a few of them here, and there are a few communities like Able Gamer community. And there are few accessible gaming projects, open source projects, which are looking after these guidelines, and they are trying to create a set of guidelines which are specific to gaming. So as we could not find any gaming specific guidelines, what we tried is, as I said, we went to POUR guidelines of WCAG2. I think everybody must be aware of WCAG2 here.
So these are those few organizations who are trying to work and develop some guidelines for making games more accessible. However, they're not those set standards, established standards as yet.
And somehow, when we find some game which is accessible, it is by coincidence and not really by design. Because very few people are aware of accessibility requirements for gaming. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. Right? Yeah. So here is the compliance standard by W3C. For websites, that is web accessibility content, content accessibility guidelines 2.0, that is WCAG 2.0, AAA guidelines. So those guidelines have been actually put under four headings. They are perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. So P stands for perceivable. It suggests that everything that you create should be perceivable for people with different abilities. So those abilities can be of any kind. I mean, like if you create a picture, you should make it perceivable to a person who cannot see it by making it, it should be accompanied by text. If you create a movie, the dialogue should be subtitled or closed captioned so that the person who is not able to hear it can enjoy that particular dialogue. So that is perceivable. Second thing is operable. That is, every person having different devices and operating capabilities should be able to operate the game. Like if I give you an interface where there is a button and you have to click it only with mouse, you cannot use keyboard to click that button, then it is not operable. So the operable means that you should be able to interact with the device or the software through various input channels. The third one is understandable. Understandable means that whatever is going on in the application is predictable. You do not see something that will disorient you. You will not find something which will not clearly make you understand what is going on. So when you delete a file, it will show you the dialogue, right? Are you sure you want to delete file? It will not delete it without your permission. So that is kind of making it understandable, because it basically informs you what is going to happen if you do something, and what, whenever it happens, what has happened. So it gives you the feedback. So that basically comes under understandability. And last is R, that is robustness. So robustness in the sense, as we have so many devices, so many browsers, like we have internet with like broadband internet, dial-up networks, so the speeds are different. Then we have small screen devices, we have flat screen TVs on which we can get IP TV and whatever. So all those things basically make it very difficult for a website or a content to be understandable by all kinds of devices. And there where this robustness comes into picture. So your content that you create or software that you create should be robust enough so that it can be rendered on various devices. And so we decided to apply these four principles to gaming. And for that we called it as scoring the games. Yeah. So when we poured the games, what we found, the Excel sheet will list it. Yeah. So, in summary, is it visible on the screen?
Not yet, I'm just scrolling it.
So okay.
It's not a summary, it's a whole table.
No, it's a table. I'll just summarize it. Okay, so what we did is we took three productivity softwares and three gaming softwares. Like earlier we took only two productivity softwares, but later we thought that if we take more softwares, it will make more sense. So we took three productivity softwares and three gaming softwares, and we applied each and every success criteria of WCAG 2.0 to that particular software. Yeah.
So here we have the productivity software category, where we have MS Word, Tally, and AutoCAD. And then we have gaming softwares, which is Minesweeper, Sudoku, and Prinz. We've chosen Prinz because it's a lot of graphics out there. So we've tried to take the small games and the big game. And then we have applied all the POUR, all the principles, and see which games or which productivity software stands where, and can you really apply it or not. So what we've seen here is, in case of P is applicable
100%
to the games and the productivity softwares both. So you see, it's all Y. Then you have
O.
The O, that's operable. It is, if you notice, it's a graph out here which will summarize the yeses and nos. So, a lot of it is applicable. However, there's some part which is not. There are some areas where O does not apply to games.
So where does it where it doesn't apply is basically we in operable we have certain guidelines which say that you should not impose a specific time limit, or you should not impose a specific interaction pattern to accomplish the task. So those particular points do not apply to gaming, because games are going to prescribe a specific interaction pattern which you have to follow. Like if there is a staircase which you have to climb up and go to the princess, you have to do that. There is no other way out. So accessibility would suggest that you should give multiple ways to do the same thing, but which gaming overrides. So those are the things which does not apply.
We have a question here. Yes.
Can we detect whether assistive technology is running on a computer, and you can ask them how much time you need. Maybe 5 minutes I take to complete it, and they can increase it to 6 to 7 minutes, depending on their requirement.
Yes, we can do that. But in that case, there is a chance that it would lose the fun part of it.
See, in a game, if you're there has to be a challenge. Right. The moment you're giving extra time, then that challenge is over. Let's say I have an exam. I have to finish my paper in about 3 hours. Right? Because I'm sloppy, if I take 5 hours. But then you lose all that.
But then that is something that I will not give exam, right?
Yeah, exactly. So
maybe increasing time could be one option if you can take it.
It's an option, but then you lose the fun. There's a lot of compromise.
No, you go on to the user.
Okay.
Okay, if I do this, he's taking his own time.
Okay.
His mission would be to accomplish it.
Alright.
He's taking so much time.
Yeah.
Okay. For persons with disabilities, it's basically, how can I do it?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not
the
main
motto behind it.
Uh-huh.
So,
okay.
And as we have been speaking at the keynote also, technology should be developed as per the user needs.
Right.
If you're not making your game by default to extend the time, you're giving the option to the user.
Okay.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay.